This is a security camera. Chances are you have one of these outside your house, protecting packages on your porch from porch pirates, or even keeping an eye out on the baby nursery. Every single company that makes these cameras claims great privacy and security, but what does that even mean? What's the standard that we're using here? I've been thinking a lot about security cameras, and up until recently, I refused to even touch them. But I really think it's important for us to develop some kind of framework to understand that delicate balance that these kind of technologies have to face: convenience versus privacy and security. These cameras are everywhere, but these questions are important, so let's talk about it. So we're gonna take a little bit of a different approach here because I recognize that all of us have different threat models and different needs. So the type of security camera that works well for me might be different than the one that works well for you or your business. So we really need to think about it in terms of a framework. What are the questions we need to ask that will get us to the bottom of the answer of what system works well for us? And I came up with a framework I'm calling SCOPE. How can we scope out the type of camera and security system that we would need? And it starts off, most importantly, with storage. How are you storing the video files that this camera creates? And there's really only two options. First, you have local storage. That could come in the form of a hub. A lot of these camera systems have some kind of hub that's either connected to the internet or it's just connected to your Wi-Fi network that allows these cameras to feed in that video feed and store those video files locally on the hub. You also have another option, a NAS, or a network attached storage, like Synology, or there's plenty of those out there, where you can connect cameras, it could be even third-party cameras, to the NAS and store all of those files on the NAS or on the hub. The value here, of course, is that you control the files. You own them and you're not giving them to anybody else. But of course, the risk is that if you have this on a hub or a NAS and an intruder comes in, they could potentially be able to grab that storage and take it with them so you no longer have access to those files. On the opposite side of that, you have cloud storage. So that's where we're uploading everything that comes into these cameras into the cloud. And it's stored there on somebody else's servers. That server could be anywhere in the world, depending on what company you use. And the access and the encryption of those files is very important to understand if you choose to do the cloud access for storage. Second, we have connectivity. How are you going to connect the camera to the system? Now, most cameras nowadays are Wi-Fi. They're using your Wi-Fi system in order to connect to the NAS, in order to connect to that central hub, which either stores the files or uploads them into the cloud, as we talked about in our storage. Then you also have wired systems. This is kind of the old CCTV system that all gets wired in. The advantage, of course, of a wired system is that you can't use any kind of Wi-Fi jammer. It's been shown many times from other people that it just takes a simple Wi-Fi jammer to render some of these cameras useless. The problem, at least in my own experience, is that most of the camera systems you're gonna find online are all Wi-Fi. It's gonna be a little bit harder to find that wired system, and when you do, you're gonna have to take the time and expense to install all the wiring and put the cameras in and make sure that everything is running properly. Okay, next, we're looking at the origin. Now, there are two primary points of origin that I'm most interested in when it comes to this kind of tech. First of all, I wanna know the origin of manufacturing. Where was this camera manufactured? And second, if we're dealing with data that has to flow through any server, where is that server located? Now, again, this is a framework, but for me personally, there are certain countries that I'm not comfortable if this kind of tech is manufactured in that country, or if any of the data, no matter how encrypted, flows through servers in that country. You might be the same, or maybe you don't care, but I think it's worth considering, what is the origin of the manufacturing? Are you okay with that? And what is the origin of the servers through which any of the data flows? And are you okay with that? All right, next in our scope, we have the pricing. This is really just a pricing model and a preference for a lot of people, but are you working on a subscription model or a one-time no subscription model? Now, personally, I don't want to add another subscription. I already have so many of them on a monthly basis. And when I'm storing most of my data locally anyway, as you'll find out in a moment, I don't see why I would want or need a subscription in the first place. There are some camera systems where it's unavoidable. You have to have the subscription, mostly because they are uploading and using cloud storage for what they're doing. But if you can avoid that, That is possible and, in my case, recommended. But that is the pricing model that you have to make a choice on. Finally, and perhaps most importantly, we want to think about the encryption. How are the files that you are creating, whether it's stored locally or whether it's stored in the cloud, how is it being encrypted? And this is something that's actually a little bit harder to find out than you might think. Sometimes you even have to reach out to the camera company because everybody's going to say that they have encryption, and they're not wrong. But how are they encrypted and who has the keys to that encryption? When you're dealing with something like the Ring cameras, those files are all uploaded to Amazon and they are encrypted, but they're also accessible by Amazon itself. So it is not a full end-to-end encryption. Same thing with the Google Nest, whereas there are other systems where it is end-to-end encrypted and you need to be able to know how that encryption works and who has access to the files. So that's the framework, but now let's take a moment to actually put that into use by applying that to a system that was sent to me that I'm currently testing in my office. So the system you see me opening here is by SafeMo. They did not sponsor this video, but they did provide this test unit for free for me to use. And what you're gonna see is that, like a lot of these type of security systems, it comes with two cameras and a base unit. This one is also designed where you could set it up with solar panels so that you don't have to hardwire it into any power source. You don't have to worry about batteries. If you have that solar panel facing the sun in some way, then it should, in theory at least, run indefinitely. So let's run this through the framework. First, storage. This camera system stores locally, with or without an internet connection. With an internet connection, I can check that storage from my mobile device. Without an internet connection, it still stores those files on the central hub, not on the camera itself, and those are accessible through the phone app whenever it is connected to the internet. So definitely some pros and cons to that, but I've decided that I do want to store it locally instead of having it up in the cloud, and that also means, go ahead and jump down to pricing, there is no subscription. So I just set it up and I can use it, and after I've purchased the system, I don't have to continue paying on a monthly basis, and that's something that I value. I don't want another subscription. As far as connectivity goes, this system by SafeMo, as well as many of the others you'll find in the market, is a Wi-Fi based system. I really didn't want to have to wire my office for two cameras, and I'm not that worried about Wi-Fi jammers. What this means is that the cameras are connected to the central hub via Wi-Fi, and that hub is connected to the internet via a wired Ethernet cable, which, as I've tested, doesn't have to be plugged in. It will still store the files, I just won't be able to access it via the mobile app if it's not connected to the internet. As for origin, I dug in to find out that SafeMo is a Singapore-based company that manufactures in Vietnam, and then I emailed them to learn that all of the data flows through servers in the United States, if that's where you're located, or for me here in Asia, through Singapore. Now again, that's not necessarily something that's going to be marketed on their website. So if it is important to you, you can either read the fine print, or in a lot of cases, you'll just have to email the company to find out, hey, how do you handle the data? Where does my data flow through whenever it's being either uploaded to the cloud, or if I'm accessing my hub through my mobile app, which is how SafeMo does this, what are the servers that are being used? And finally, we look at encryption. For a lot of companies that upload to the cloud, the encryption question is, do you have the keys and do they have the keys? When we're dealing with local storage, you need to understand how you're accessing that local storage. For SafeMo, I have a mobile app, and I had to ask and find out from SafeMo that my connection between that app into my hub goes through one of their servers, but that connection is end-to-end encrypted, meaning that only I can view, and it's not being stored in their servers, it is just passing through from the local storage. Now, personally, I wish that I could just grab it off of my hub, but that's not the way this system is designed, and that's where something like a NAS, Synology, might be a better option if that's what you're more comfortable with. You would have to use a VPN connection or some other kind of connection to be able to get in and view that, or just view it locally. But how you connect and view those files is really important, and that is the encryption that we're looking at. So this is the system that I'm currently testing in my office. It has on-camera AI detection. It also will send me encrypted notifications if it senses somebody entering into my studio. I can check the live feed to find out who that is. I'll have links to SafeMo below this description, but I also recognize that what works for me might be different than what works for you, or maybe you already have a system. So I want to know, what are the things that all of us can do to make sure that our camera system is as safe and as secure as possible? To start off with, I think we all need to be really careful about where we put our cameras. I think pointing out on our porch, that's not really a big deal. Most of us don't even really think much about that. But especially if you've got a camera inside, like let's say in the nursery, make sure it's pointing only at the crib, not at like the changing table or something like that. I know this seems a little common sense, but you'd be surprised. It's a whole lot easier to just set up these really wide angle cameras to point at the entire room. And that can be a little bit dangerous, especially if you have it inside your personal space. I have my camera here in my studio, but I don't know if I'd ever feel comfortable putting it in my house, maybe outside my house. But my studio has a lot of expensive equipment. I wanna make sure that I'm protecting that as best I can. I don't know if I would give up the privacy of having a camera in my house in order to do that same thing. Second, and this is huge, you need to make sure that you have a very good username and password for whatever system you use to access the files, whether you put them locally or in the cloud, especially if they're in the cloud. Do not use the same password that you've used elsewhere. I would even recommend not even using the same username, whether that's an email or a username that you use commonly everywhere else. You need to make sure that these are unique username and passwords, because the last thing you want is for somebody to be able to hack into your account to access any of these files or to gain access of your camera. I know that there's not a whole lot that somebody can do, and there's not a lot of incentive for somebody to hack security systems, but in the cases where it has happened, it feels really invasive, and it's a simple fix by just making sure you have a really good username and password. Next, if you use a mobile app to access either the stored footage or even the live feed of the cameras that you have, be sure that that app is locked down, not just behind the PIN code for your actual phone, but actually lock the app. On an Apple device, on newer iOSs, you can long press on that and then set to force Face ID. That means that you can't use the PIN code for the camera to open it up, and so it has to be your face that opens that. It's a small security step, but I think it's really important if you're accessing this footage from your phone. Next, make sure that in the cases where you have to turn on end-to-end encryption, that you've done so. So for example, the Ring cameras from Amazon, they allow for end-to-end encryption, but you have to go in and enable it. It's not on by default. So in those cases where end-to-end encryption is a user option, but it has to be turned on, make sure that you go into your settings and do that. And finally, as with any online account, if there is an option for two-factor authentication, I don't care whether that's an authenticator app with a six-digit code or a 2FA key, make sure that you've set up that 2FA so that it's not just your username and password, but you're also protecting that with two-factor authentication. That's security cameras. Go ahead and leave a comment below to let me know which system you eventually land on and why. I'd be really curious to hear. And watch this video next, where I walk through all of my favorite secure email providers and the features that they provide. Take care.